before, but never quite this way. It's like an all-out war with monsters at obey.
What's up, everyone? Welcome to NS Game Review CCG Edition. So, if you remember about this time last year, I took a look at Star Wars Young Jedi. Mainly because, hey, there's a new Star Wars movie in theaters. Well, it's December 2016, and hey, there's a new Star Wars movie in theaters. Anyways, I had a request a while back asking if I was going to take a look at the other Star Wars card game, the one made by Wizards of the Coast. And I figured, well, there's another new Star Wars movie in theaters. So I figured this would be a good opportunity to do another Star Wars game. So this time around, I'm taking a look at the Star Wars trading card game by Wizards of the Coast. The expansion, I believe itself for the deck I have is called Attack of the Clones. I believe there are other expansions for it. I don't know any of them. Unlike Young Jedi, these are the only cards I have for this. And it's actually a two-player starter deck. We'll get a bit into the nuances about that. But there is both a light side and a dark side 30-card deck in here. And yeah, it's going to be one of those games like Young Jedi. Now, I don't remember hardly anything about Young Jedi because, truth be told, most of these games that I take a look at, I have hardly ever touched before I did the review, and I've hardly touched after. There are a couple games I do enjoy playing, one or two that I play constantly, but that's really it. So my memory tends to just completely wipe of past things. So it's going to be hard for me to draw on the similarities between this and Young Jedi, because I don't remember much about Young Jedi, but I do know the whole light side, dark side deck thing was one of my biggest nuances with that game. It's going to be kind of one of the bigger ones with this one. So, if you've never seen these videos before, what happens is after this little intro, I will go into the different card types, talk about what they do, well, more or less show you the anatomy of a card and what it looks like, and then I'll talk about deck construction briefly, then we'll come back with a look of how the game works, and then my final thoughts on it. So, let's go ahead and take a look at the different card types. The Star Wars trading card game uses 5 different card types, though the first two look the same, as well as the last 3. First up are mission cards, which represent things that happened in the Star Wars universe and have a yellow border. All cards will have a side icon in the upper left corner notating whether it's a light side card with a blue lightsaber, a dark side card with a red lightsaber, or a neutral card with a yellow and black symbol. Mission cards have a build cost in the upper right corner, and we'll get to building cards later on. But it's strange how the orientation of the build cost number doesn't match the orientation of the card. Weird. Anyway, once the building of a mission card is complete, it's flipped face up, the effects go off, and then it's discarded. Battle cards represent actions and tactics taken during battle, and have a red border. Battle cards can be used to help your own units or hinder your opponents. They don't have a build cost, but some have a force cost instead. Battle cards are played only during the battle phase, and only when it's your turn, during a play or pass chance, this game's version of fast effect timing from Magic the Gathering. Once played, and any force costs paid, the effects go off and the card is placed into the discard pile. The last 3 card types are all unit cards and share the same card anatomy. Space units represent starships, have a blue border, and fight in the space arena. Ground units represent infantry and vehicles, have a green border, and fight in the ground arena. Characters represent the various characters in the Star Wars universe, have a purple border, and fight in the character arena. The build cost for units is in the upper left corner, and all cards will have a type, plus some will have a subtype, and this also includes mission and battle cards. Going down the left side, we have numbers for speed, power, and health. Speed determines when a unit can attack. The higher the speed, the faster it can attack. If there is a tie for the highest speed between the light and dark side, the dark side will go first. Power represents how many dice you'll roll when that unit attacks to see how many times it hits. Health represents how many hits a unit can take before it's discarded or destroyed. As with other card games, there's also a text box that will show any abilities a unit might have, some again requiring a force cost. There might also be a version letter to the right of a unit's text box that denotes it's a unique unit and follows special rules. Deck building for the game isn't too difficult, but there's a little more to remember than in most games. Your deck has to have at least 60 cards with no more than 4 of any card of the same name and version. Your deck cannot contain both light and dark side cards, though either deck can contain neutral cards. You have to have at least 12 of each type of unit card, but you can't have more than twice as many of one type than another. For instance, you can't have a deck that contains 12 ground units and 25 space units, because 25 is more than twice as many as 12. That's it for card types and how to build a deck. Let's go ahead and see how the game itself works. So now we've taken a look at the different card types, let's see how they work. So you notice right up on top here, I have these two cards that say stop, have a big stop sign on them. So this game has very beginner rules that introduce the core mechanics of the game or whatever. And then it has the actual game itself, how the game is really supposed to be played. So these cards here at the stop signs are pretty much saying these are the cards you need for the first time you play this game, and that's it. Beyond that, these aren't needed. I've already got these separated out between all the cards for light side and dark side. Again, a deck cannot have both, but either deck can have neutral cards. And I believe, much like Young Jedi, one person has to play light, one person has to play dark. I understand why in terms of, you know, light versus dark, I get that, but in terms of a card game, it's just a little weird. So, let's go ahead and get started with these setup. Now, I've already got these decks shuffled, just to make things a little easier. First thing that happens is, each side will draw 7 cards. And for the sake of having room, put the dark side down here. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and the light side up here. Now, the main way of playing the majority of the cards in this game is by building them. And I mentioned the build cost on a lot of the cards. So, when you build a card, you'll have a certain amount of build points each turn that you can spend to play a card. Basically, it's just you show the card you're going to play, you spend that many build points, and then you put it into the proper arena. And there are 3 arenas. There is a game mat that comes with the game. And I forgot to show it before I laid this out, but just simply put, you basically have spots for your deck, your discard pile, what's considered your build zone, where cards will go when they're being built, and then you have 3 arenas, one for space, one for ground, and one for actual characters, your 3 types of units. I can't remember on which order they're in, but they're always like facing each other, so you have your 2 space, your 2 ground, and your 2 character. The mat shows that, you know, dark side's on one side of the mat, light's specifically for the other, but as long as you remember which arena is where in that order, you should be fine. So, each turn I'll get into building a little bit more, the nuance, or, well, not nuances, but specifics of it. But normally for each turn, a die would be rolled to see how many build points each player gets. And this is a game where both players pretty much do something each turn, instead of alternating turns. But for the initial setup, basically you're going to go back and forth playing units until you have no more than 30 build points worth of cards on the table. Let me demonstrate. Make sure I got the right deck. Okay, because the dark side will actually start first, and at any time there's a tie for anything, in terms of, well, mostly for speed, in terms of, like, if there's a tie for which character needs to attack, it's based on speed, and they each have the same speed, the dark side will always win ties. In terms of building and attacking, whatever, well, at least in terms of building, and we'll talk about retreating, the dark side goes first. So a setup, the dark side goes first. Now, the dark side will go through their hand, pick any unit, as long as it's a unit. I know that mission cards also have a build cost. You cannot build units here, or you cannot build missions here and complete them. This is specifically for units. So they can take a unit card. In this case, I'll take the Commerce Guild Droid 8-1.
and put it in the, since it's green, it'll go in the ground unit arena. And then it'll go ahead and draw a card to replace that. Now, the Commerce Guild Droid 81, I can't talk today, normally has a build point cost of 6. And by the way, any when-built abilities will not go off during setup. So those are all ignored. So now the light side will play units one at a time from their hand until they exceed 6. So for instance, they could play, let's go with Padme Amidala, which is a character that has a 3 build cost. They will immediately draw to replace that card. And they are still lower than 6, or they have not exceeded 6 yet, so they could then play Clone Warrior 5/373. You may see me, for purposes of this demonstration, kind of put my cards like that. We're going to go into a concept here in a little bit about called stacking. That's probably going to be towards the end of this. I'm just showing the core rules for now. This is not stacking. This is just me, for the time being, putting my cards here to make room on the table. But we'll get into the concept of actually stacking later. So I have 3 and 6, so I have 6. But since they also built 6, I have to exceed that. I can play one more card. Make sure I draw the place where I just played. And then I will go ahead and play Clone Platoon in the ground arena. So now, the light side player has 4, 7, 10 build points worth of units. So then the dark side player, did I draw to replace that? No, I did. That's one of my biggest things with card games, is when you're supposed to replace what you just drew. I sometimes forget that. So now we'll go back over to the dark side. And they now have to exceed 10. Well, we're currently sitting at 6. So we're going to... they need some characters over here, so we're going to play... Sam Wessel. No, that's not... Vessel, that is Whistle. In the... I know, I'm putting a Star Trek joke in a Star Wars video, I'm sorry. Putting him in the character arena... So he now has a total of 9 points. Draw to replace. And we're going to go ahead and put Techno Union Starship in the space arena. And he's up to 15. The light side then responds and must exceed 15. So sitting at 10, we would go ahead and play... Well, we need some space units here. We'll go and play N1 Starfighter to put the 12. Let's do another N1 Starfighter. Let's go up to 14. And then we'll do Corellian Star Shuttle to go up to 19. And this will keep going back and forth until one side hits 30. Or one side cannot play anything else that would exceed them to 30. Let me explain. So 30 is the limit, but you can't go over 30. You either stop at 30... Or if you don't want to play anything else, or can't play anything else because it would take you over 30, you can then partially build something. So, let's say, for instance, I have... let's give me a good example. So let's say, for instance, I have other cards on the table as a light side. And let's say I'm at 29 points. Or let's say I'm at 28 points. And I wanted to put another Clone Platoon into play. Well, Clone Platoon has a build cost of 4. That would put me at 32 if I just played it, and I can't do that since I can't go over 30. So what you can do is you can partially build something, which means you would basically show it to your opponent, saying, this is what I'm building. Then you take the card, put it face down in front of you, and put on however many build points you want up. That would take your total up to 30. So, like, for instance, let's say I had 28 points already on the board. I can actually put... I had it. Here it is. I can actually go ahead and put 2 build points on here. Now, again, we'll get more into building cards later during when we get into the main phases of the game. But when you're doing setup and building, you do show what you're building to your opponent before you place it face down. That, I believe, is to make sure that you're not saying, okay, well, actually, I'm not 100% certain. But I know during setup, you show the unit to your opponent. When you build later on, you won't. So, then let's say that, okay, this is exactly a 30. Now, the dark side will go to exactly 30. And that's essentially it. That's how setup works. So, with that said, we'll be back in just a moment. I'm going to get things a little more set up, and we'll go and show how a turn actually progresses. So, we got a bit of a setup going here. This is after everything is already played through. So, both sides have exactly 30 build points worth of units. Nobody had to partially build anything. I did forget to mention one thing back when I started, and that is when you have your opening hand of 7 cards, if you don't like what you drew, you're allowed to take a single mulligan, where you can take any number of mission and battle cards in your hand, shuffle them back into your deck, and draw that many. Basically because you can't build mission or battle card, well you can't build battle cards at all, but you also can't build mission cards, so during the setup phase, so at the very beginning of the game, you want more units to be actually be able to build them. So there are 4 phases in the game itself. There's the ready phase, the command phase, the battle phase, and the end phase. For the ready phase, the first thing you do is untap anything you have tapped. And this isn't a situation where it's like, okay, well they're rested now, or they were exhausted, now they're rested. This is Wizard of the Coast. They use tap and untap. So, you untap anything that was tapped, which at the beginning of the game you're not going to do. Second, both players will gain 4 force, or 4 force points. Force points are used for abilities, I believe some battle cards will have you pay in force. And we'll get to abilities in a little bit. So both players will have 4 force points to spend. And as far as I know, those are cumulative. They don't go away, at least not to my knowledge. And finally, each player will draw 1 card. And that is the ready phase. Next up is the command phase. So, first off, any abilities that go off when the command phase starts will go ahead and go off. Next, the light side player will actually roll a die to see how many build points each side gets. So, the game thoughtfully comes with a bunch of little dice and tokens. So you don't have to supply your own. Yeah. If you have a bunch of D6s, they're probably going to be your best friends during this. So, these are also used to show how much damage units have, how many force points you have. Dice, pen, and paper are your best friends. Here we go. Plus, they really only give you 2 force tokens. Huh, it's really weird. Anyways, so the light side player, because, you know, the dark side does everything first, we'll roll a d6, and each player gains that many build points for the turn, plus a bonus build point if they control a unit in all 3 arenas. So, each turn, both players can get a maximum of 1-7 build points. And it's not that the light side player rolls and then the dark side player rolls. Whatever the light side player rolls, that's how many both players get. So in this case, I rolled a 2. Both players have a unit in all 3 arenas, so both players get 3 build points for the turn. But of course, the dark side goes first. I don't know why the dark side goes first in these games. I really don't understand that. So, 3 build points kind of as a little counter. Again, dice are your best friends in this game. So, building now works somewhat similar to how setup worked, except that when each side does their building, they will do all of their building at one time. And in this case, it works slightly a bit differently, as you can now also play mission cards if you wish. So for instance, I could spend, as the dark side player, one of my mission points if I want to build and use the mission Splinter the Republic, which allows me to search my deck and then take a card from my deck with the same name as one of my units in any arena, show it to my opponent, put it into my hand, and shuffle my deck. So in those cases, I would build it. I don't think you have to necessarily play it face down. You can, I guess, if you want. I don't know if I have any mission cards that are more than one build point. But if so, you basically play it face down, spend your build point, flip it face up, do its effects, and then it's discarded. In terms of units, you can say go ahead and play unit face down, spend the build points you want on it, and then if it is enough build points that you can deploy it, then you're going to turn it face up and deploy it to the proper arena. In that case, the Geonosian fighter, I'm probably mispronouncing that, costs exactly 3 build points, so I can go ahead and deploy it if I wish. Now, I didn't have to deploy it. I could have just left it right there with the 3 build points on it. Or, you know, because I don't want my only... The dark side doesn't want their only fighter to be decimated. They decided to go ahead and deploy it. So let's say if I decide not to do that. I mentioned earlier about partially building stuff. So, again, unlike the setup phase, you don't show what you're building to your opponent before you actually build it. So in this case, you can place a card face down, put 3 build points on it, and there you go. Your opponent has no idea what you just played. It's also worth noting, you don't have to put, or you don't have to pay the amount of build points on the card itself. So let's say on another turn we got, say, 5 build points. If I really wanted to, I can go ahead and play, let's play this face down, and I'm going to put 4 build points on it. So I must be building something pretty big, or even better, yeah, let's just put all 5 build points on it. I'm going crazy over here. So 5 build points there, and the light side here is now I got to figure out what are they building, and where's it going to go, and why does it take 5 build points? Well, here's the thing. You can never remove build points from anything. So it's not like, all of a sudden, oh, well, I really don't want 5 there. Let's knock it down to 4 or 3 or 2. Once you use a build point on something, it's on there. And there is no refund. I say that because this card I actually put 5 build points on only needs 3 to be deployed. So basically, you can kind of bluff your opponent like that, making them think that you're building something bigger than what you actually are. But since that only needed 3 build points, and I put 5 on there, I don't get that extra 2 back. All 5 are gone. Think of it, I guess, as like your... I really can't think of a good example that would make sense. I was going to liken it to maybe putting money in like an arcade machine or like a pop machine. But even then, your extra coins go towards something else. So, can't really think of much else. I guess in a way, it's like if you're rinsing something off or if you're watering something and you got the sink running over it and you got water flowing everywhere, you don't get that water back. I know that's a really lame example, but I can't think of anything else. Bottom line is, unused build points don't get refunded. On that same note, any build points you don't use, you don't keep. It's not like force points, which go over. Again, as far as I know, force points go over, or will accumulate. So we'll say that the dark side used their 3 build points to build the fighter. Oops, I'm sorry. The squadron. Now, unlike the setup phase, again, here you don't draw a card to replace what you just did. So they're now out of build points. If they weren't, let's say that only took 2... they could still build something else. It's not like you only play 1 and then the light side has to match or exceed it. So, but in this case, he used all 3. It is now the light side player's turn, and they have their 3 build points. So, let's see what I got to deal with. We're looking a little down on ground units, so we're going to spend all 3 to play Elite Jedi Squad. I'm sorry. Technically, it'd be face down, play 3 build points. That is enough to deploy it, so you can go ahead and deploy it. So in that case, both players have used up all their build points. Again, any excess does not carry over. So, next comes retreating. You might be thinking to yourself, Why would you retreat? Well, let's say you have something really huge that you don't want targeted, because we'll get into battling in just a minute and how targeting works. But let's say that you have a really powerful fighter, but their speed is pretty low. They're not going to be attacking right away. So your opponent may be targeting it first, and you don't necessarily want to lose that. During retreating, again, Dark Side will go first. They can take any units they want that are in any of the arenas. They can tap them, and then move them back to their build zone. You don't have to rebuild them. And then they'll stay there until the next build phase, or build step, in which you can go ahead and redeploy them. Now, there is a catch to that, though, and you got to be careful about retreating in this case. And by the way, after the Dark Side retreats whatever they want, then the Light Side can retreat whatever they want. The goal of the game is to control two out of the three arenas. You control an arena when you have something in there, but your opponent doesn't. So you may not want that nice, powerful ship to get targeted a lot right away, or you may be completely outnumbered and maybe you want to hang back a bit. But at the same time, you don't want to give your opponent control of that arena. Because when they gain two, and I believe it's only checked at the end phase, and that I will bring this up. Yeah, the check for controls only happened at the end phase, but there's not really much you can do in between to make any difference. So, be very careful about what you want to retreat and make sure you want to retreat it, because again, it's not going to go back into play until your next command phase comes around and it's time to build and deploy again. So next up is the battle phase. And I'm going to briefly talk about a concept called player pass. Player pass in this game is essentially like doing fast effects in Magic the Gathering. It's an opportunity to use abilities and play cards. So there are a couple instances, I mean, while player pass chances will normally happen during battle, there are a couple of other instances that player pass will trigger. First is dice rolling. Whenever a player rolls a dice, It's always good to have the manual on hand. So whenever a player rolls a dice or die, a player chance pass will occur, and that will enable players to play cards and abilities that can make the player re-roll the dice. And only those abilities can be played here. When both players pass in a row, the player pass chance ends, the dice rolled cannot be re-rolled anymore, and then the effects occur. I'm guessing that's for any dice roll. There's no specific mention of what kind. So whether it's rolling for you're rolling your power to do damage, whether it's rolling for another ability, whether it's rolling to see how many build points you get per turn, I'm assuming it's good for all of those. The other trigger for player pass outside of battle is damage. If damage is about to be done, a player pass chance will occur that enables players to play cards and abilities that prevent some or all of the damage. Only cards and abilities that contain prevent, evade, or deflect can be played at this time. When both players pass in a row, the player pass chance ends, and the damage can no longer be prevented, and the damage counters are put onto the affected units. If new damage is created during damage prevention player pass chance, that damage will wait for the current player pass chance to end, and then a new player pass chance will actually come up for the new damage. That's getting a little complicated. So let's go ahead and walk through how a battle takes place. So first of all, I mentioned that dice are your best friends. Whether you're using them for damage counters or just for rolling, you're going to need some. So, you will fight all three, basically you're going to be fighting in all three arenas. The combat order is determined by the speed of the units, and you go in order of space, then ground, then character. So first, you find who has the, or what unit in that arena has the highest attack speed. In this case, it's going to be the N1 Starfighter. I have two of them over on the light side with a speed of 60. So if there's a tie between the highest speed between the two sides, the dark side always wins ties. If it's just within one, like I have two N1 Starfighters that have 60 speed, or even if I had another character or unit over here that had 60 speed, I can choose which one of them will attack first, as long as they're the highest. So, I'm going to go ahead and pick this N1 Starfighter. Good speed, kind of crappy everywhere else. Basically, they're easy targets, but they go first, usually in this case. Anyways, so whether or not you're going to, well, before you decide if you're going to attack with the unit, if it has any abilities that will cause it to tap that you can use now, you can go ahead and use them if you wish, but keep in mind that once you tap it to use an ability, you can't tap it to attack. Or rather, you can't attack with a period. So, barring that, you're going to go ahead and decide to whether or not you want to attack with a unit. So, whether or not you attack, you actually tap your unit, which is a little different than Magic, where if you're not going to attack with a creature, you don't tap it, you just leave it there. This is different. Whether or not you want to attack, it taps. So, once it is tapped, you go ahead and choose what you're going to attack. In this case, I'm going to go for the Techno Union Starship, because it's got low speed. It's going to be about the fourth unit to attack this turn, so I can get both my Starfighters to weaken it a little bit. And it does 6 power, and it's a lot of health, so I'm going to go ahead and weaken it first. Or at least try to weaken it first. The alternative could be you could try to take out the droid Starfighter, but you're going to see why that's going to be a little difficult here in just a moment. So I'm going to try to weaken the more powerful ship first. So after you choose what you're attacking, a player pass chance will go ahead and occur. Does either side, or starting with the dark side, do they have anything they can do? Looking through what they have. No. They don't have anything, so they're going to pass. Does the light side have anything they can do? No, because, and something really stupid, just to get this out of the way, and this is, I don't set up these scenarios. This is all how the cards come up off the top of the deck. All the dark side's battle cards add damage, and all the light side battle cards right now prevent it. So for this battle, it's not going to help at all. So nothing will happen with player pass. So the attacker goes ahead, rolls a number of d6s equal to the power. N1 Starfighter's power is 2, so goes ahead and rolls 2 dice. For every 1, 2, or 3 that comes up, the unit will deal 2 or 1 damage to the target. I'm sorry. Every 1, 2, or 3 comes up is a miss. Every 4, 5, or 6 that comes up is a hit for 1 damage on the target. In this case, nothing. So, normally in this case, a player pass chance would happen once the dice are rolled. After the player pass chance occurs, usually in this case, to help prevent damage, then you determine how many hits. Okay, actually I take that back. I was just glancing at the manual real quick. Once the dice are rolled, a player pass chance for re-rolling will occur, which I mentioned earlier because someone rolled dice. So after that player pass chance occurs, determine how many hits there are. Again, every 4, 5, or 6 is a hit. In this case, nothing hit. Then another player pass chance for preventing damage would happen. Then you would put 1 damage counter on the defending unit for each hit. The attack would end, and then you have one more player pass chance. So, in the case of the attack here, nothing hit. So, that ends that attack. Next up would be my other N1 Starfighter, because it now has the highest attack. So I'll go ahead and tap it. Same thing, both cards, as long as the light side is attacking, neither cards in their hands are going to do anything. So we'll go ahead and just roll 2 more dice. And we got 2 hits. So in that case, the Techno Union Starship now has 2 damage on it. So we'll go ahead and I got the white dice over here that came with the game. I'll go ahead and plop a 2 on there for 2 damage. So, of the 3 remaining units in the space arena, the droid Starfighter Squadron now has the highest speed, so it gets to attack. And it will attack. It's going to attack the Corellian Star Shuttle, the only thing that has not attacked yet. It's actually got 3 power. It's going to be attacking last, so might as well try to take it down. So, again, It's a tap that's going to attack a player pass chance will happen. I'm not going to do anything yet. So now we go ahead and determine the number of dice, and we're going to go ahead and roll them real quick. In this case, it's going to be 3. I'm just dropping dice all over the place today. There we go. So, 3 power, go ahead and roll the dice. So now the dice rolling has occurred, and before it's assigned, if there's anything that can happen to re-roll dice, it can go ahead and take place now. That's prevent damage, that's prevent damage, hey, that's prevent damage. The light side can only prevent damage. The dark side can add power, which obviously isn't going to help now. Or getting critical for an attack. So nothing that can affect dice rolls. Because remember, only things that can affect dice rolls happen at this player pass, since the dice were just rolled. So, nothing that affects that. So now it's time to assign the damage. In that case, the 2 points of damage here for rolling a 4 and a 6 are going to go towards the Corellian Star Shuttle. If I don't want to prevent it, I'm actually considering that the Techno Union Starship still has to attack and it has 6 power. I've only got 4 health. I may want to do something about that. So, we're going to go ahead and play Pilot's Dodge, which is pay 2 force of the 4 I have to prevent up to 2 damage to one of my space and ground units. So, I can play this during the player pass chance for preventing damage. It's discarded, and that 2 damage will be prevented. It is worth noting that if you have an ability that states you can pay force to play it, you can only play it, I believe, once per attack, so to speak. Like, over here with the characters, when we get to character battles, Anakin Skywalker has the ability to pay 1 force to evade 1. That means, for an attack, whenever something attacks me, I can pay 1 force to evade 1 damage. That doesn't mean I can, for instance, pay 3 force to evade 3 damage. It's for each attack, I can pay 1 to evade 1. So, basically, once per turn or battle or what have you. So, I dodge that, so to speak. Next, the Techno Union Starship will go ahead and attack. And it's actually going to do something now. After it has decided to attack and choose the target of Corellian Star Shuttle, it's going to play a Surge of Power. Pay 1 force and one of your units get +2 power for this attack. So in other words, now instead of rolling 6 dice, it's going to roll 8 dice. It's called you prevent that 2 damage. I'm going to add 2 more chances. So, there's nothing over here that we can do, and all of the cards over here are for preventing damage, which can't be played yet. So we'll go ahead and roll the dice. That was kind of a pitiful roll. Actually, not really. There are no abilities used to do rerolls. Now we determine how much damage there's going to be. In this case, there is 4. So now, the light side player look back through their hand, pay another 2 force, dropping down to 0, to play a second pilot's dodge. Same thing, it prevents 2 damage. So 2 of it will still go through, the other 2 is prevented. And with that, the Corellian Star Shuttle is the only thing left that hasn't attacked. Yes, it will tap. It will choose a target. In this case, we're going to go ahead and go with the Techno Union Starship to try to wipe it out. And they will roll 3 dice for their power. Again, nothing either side can do can be done during player pass right now. Roll a 3. Lands 1 hit. And there we go. At this point, all space battles have now been resolved. So now you will do the same thing with the ground units, and then the same thing with character units. And once all 3 arenas are completely done, the battle phase ends. Then you move on to the end phase, which The only thing that really happens during the end phase is you check to see if the game's over. Again, if at this point during the end phase, if one player controls at least two arenas, they win. And again, you control an arena by having a unit in there when at least one unit in there when your opponent doesn't. So, in the gist of the core rules, that's how the game works. There is one more thing we need to cover, though, and I don't have the cards to demonstrate this example. So, I'm going to actually be reading out of the book for this. So, some cards in the game are considered unique, and these actually represent unique characters. Like, for instance, Anakin Skywalker here, you see has a little version letter down the corner, it's D. Obviously, you can't have more than one Anakin Skywalker in play at a time, or more than one Obi-Wan Kenobi. So any character with a letter off to the right in that little area shows that as a unique character, and each one may have multiple versions. So, let's see, how to best explain this. You can only have one of a particular unit in battle or retreated at any one time, regardless of what version it is. Again, you can't have two Anakins or two Obi-Wans. Now, we won't talk about stacking in just a moment, but if you do have two, and they're not stacked, you have to discard the one you deployed most recently. Now, some unique cards do have different names, but they're treated as though their names were the same for the purposes of the rules for unique cards. So, Anakin Skywalker and Darth Vader are considered the same, Chancellor Palpatine and Senator Palpatine are considered the same, and Padme Amidala and Queen Amidala are considered the same. So, what happens when you deploy a unique unit during setup? More than likely, you don't have to really worry. Well, we'll get into contested in just a moment. So, there are certain rules you gotta use if you have a unique unit in the battle or during setup and you want to play it again later. And first of all, it's gotta be a different version. So you can't put like a Anakin Skywalker D and stack it with an Anakin Skywalker D. Second, you have to stack it with the other one. So, we'll get to stacking during setup in just a moment. But if you put a unique unit into battle during setup, your opponent can put the same unique unit into battle on their side. Later, when the first battle phase occurs, those units will be contested. So, this will usually only happen with neutral units, since one player's got dark side, one player's got light side, but you can both use neutral units. So, let's say you each got the same neutral unit in play. Well, during the first battle phase of the game, they are now going to be contested. When they are contested, players will bid force to see who wins the contest. The bidding starts at zero, and players can't bid more force than they currently have. The dark side player bids first, and he or she can raise the bid or pass. Then the light side player will bid and they'll go back and forth until they both pass. When the bidding ends, take your final force bid, add your unit's build cost, then add one for each card stacked under it, if they're stacked. The player with the highest total wins the bid, and the dark side wins ties. The winner of the contest pays force equal to his or her final force build, and his or her unit stays in battle. The losing player pays no force, but his or her unit retreats. And then there are more than one pair of contested units, the dark side player chooses which pair to bid on first. So what about stacking, as I mentioned that? Stacking is when you put one unique card on top of or underneath another version of the same unique card during your build phase. This lets you use more than one version of a unique card at once. A stacked unit has the type, speed, power, health, and text box of the card on top of the stack. All the other cards in the stack are ignored, but for each card underneath the unit on top will get +10 speed, +1 power, and +1 health. Stacks of cards have several rules. You can't stack cards that are not unique. A stack cannot have more than four cards on it, or in it. You can't stack cards unless they have the same name. The exceptions for this we mentioned earlier. It's like you can't stack Chancellor Palpatine version A of Darth Vader, but you can stack them with Senator Palpatine A, or you can stack an Anakin Skywalker with a Darth Vader. You can't put a unique card into a stack that already has the exact same version of that card. So if you have a stack in battle that contains Chancellor Palpatine A, you can't put another Chancellor Palpatine A into the stack. However, you could put a Chancellor Palpatine A. However, you could put a Senator Palpatine A into that stack. So in other words, you can't, like I said earlier, you can't put like an Anakin Skywalker D on top of an Anakin Skywalker D. You can't put a Chancellor Palpatine A on top of a Chancellor Palpatine A, but you can put a Chancellor Palpatine A on top of a Senator Palpatine A, because they are considered the same person, but it's not the exact same card. A stack is a single unit in all ways. If the stacked unit is discarded, all cards in it are discarded. Once a card is in the stack, it can't be removed. So, how do you make a stack? And I apologize that you're seeing just a static, sort of a static image of my cards here, but I have no character that I have multiple versions of in this deck, so I can't really show it physically. If you have a unique unit in battle or retreated, and you want to build another version of the same card during your build steps, special rules apply. If the new card's build cost is less than or equal to the existing card's cost, if the existing one is on a stack, you go by what's on top. You can deploy it once you have one or more build counters on it. Then you can put the new card on top of the old one or underneath on the bottom or underneath it, your choice. If the new card's build cost is more than the existing card's cost, you have two choices. To put the new card under the old one, you can deploy the new card once you have one or more build card or counters on it. To put the new card on top of the stack instead, you need to figure out how many build counters you need to have on it before you deploy it. To do this, just take the difference between the two cards' build costs plus one. So for that example, if you have Anakin Skywalker C in battle, his build cost is 5, and you want to build Anakin Skywalker A with a build cost of 7. To put him on the bottom, you just got to have one build counter. But to put him on top, you have to put 3 build counters on him. 2 for the difference between 5 and 7, and then 1 more. Putting a new card underneath or on top of the stack has no effect on the number of damage counters on it. During your build phase, you can spend build points to rearrange cards in the stack so a different one is on top. If the card you want on top has a higher build cost than the one already on top, pay the difference in points all in one turn. If the card you want on top has a lower build cost, you can put it on top for free. Rearranging cards in the stack has no effect on the number of damage counters. But what if you want to stack during setup? You can stack different versions of a unique card during setup. If the new card's build cost is less than the one already in battle, just put it underneath. If the new card's build cost is equal to or more than the one already in battle, you can put the new one on top or underneath, your choice. Then, of course, you draw a card to replace it. During setup, the top card of the stack is the one that counts towards your total build cost. The other cards in the stack count as though they each had a build cost of 1, regardless of what the cost actually is. So, that's it for stacking. I know I kind of went through it a little quickly, but again, I have no way of actually demonstrating it. The only other real thing of note are the keyword abilities, and there are a few. For instance, you have Bombard, which says this unit may attack a unit in the ground arena instead of a unit in the space arena, using X power plus any other effects. So I guess this is for space units, can actually attack ground units that way. Critical Hit X is this unit does X more damage if you roll at least one natural 6. But no matter how many 6s you roll, the unit still only does X more damage. Deflect X to prevent X damage to this unit, and this unit may do that much damage to a unit of your choice in the same arena. Now you can only play Deflect during damage prevention player pass chances. It prevents damage to the unit that has the ability, and in addition, can also damage another unit. The damage is done within a new damage prevention player pass chance after the current one. We talked about that situation earlier. The damage that the unit does equals the damage it prevented. You can apply Deflect only once for each source and each damage prevention player pass chance. Evade, prevent up to X damage to this unit. I mentioned that a little bit ago. You can play Evade only during damage prevention player pass chance if it prevents damage to the unit. You can only play Evade abilities once for each source and each damage prevention player pass chance. Ion Cannon X says this unit may attack a unit in the space arena instead of a unit in the ground arena. So basically, whereas Bombard was space attacking ground, Ion Cannon is ground attacking space. And then Shields X, each unit gets minus X power as long as it's attacking this unit. So yeah. And that's essentially, yeah, no, those last couple things I couldn't really demonstrate because I don't have the proper cards. That's what happens when you got two 30-card starter decks, but that's pretty much all there is for Star Wars. I'll be back in just a minute with my final thoughts. So that pretty much wraps it up for Star Wars, specifically Attack of the Clones, my least favorite of the Star Wars movies. But what do I actually think of the game? Honestly, I thought this is rather enjoyable. I mean, Young Jedi, I liked it. I heard it was more for like beginners, like trying to get into card games. This seems to require a bit more strategy, especially when it comes to what you want to build, where you want to build it, if you want to retreat or not, making sure you actually keep something in each arena so your opponent doesn't control it. So between the two, if I had to pick which one I prefer, I would probably prefer this one. Now, that's not to say I think it's the greatest game of all time. It still kind of irks me that you have to have a dark side and a light side. Now, yes, there are neutral cards that either player can use. And I understand the whole, struggle between dark and light, but would it really be that big of an issue if you had, say, like two light sides, just kind of sparring with each other, or training regimens for the dark side going up against each other? Simulations, if you will. I don't think that would have been too much of a stretch. And unless there are actually cards that reference light and dark side, you might be able to stretch the rules a little bit, make your own house rules for actually being able to do that, like light side and dark side simulations. Just determine who's going to be the dark side in terms of who goes first every time. But beyond that, yeah, say if you're into Star Wars, this is probably the, at least to me, the better of the two games. Now, again, it's not to say Young Jedi is not good. I enjoyed Young Jedi. But given the choice between the two, I would probably, can't tell what I was doing. I was putting dice back in my container and one actually went up my shirt sleeve as I was trying to dump it out. But given the choice between the two, I would probably go with this one. But again, that's just me. So with that, that's all I got for the Star Wars trading card game. If you have not seen Rogue One yet and plan to, I hope you enjoy it. If you did see it, I hope you enjoyed it. I've not seen it yet. I will eventually, and I hope I enjoy it. So with that, I thank you guys for watching, and I'll see you next time.
Hey everyone, thanks for checking out my review of the other Star Wars trading card game. Seriously, the only ones I've heard of are this and Young Jedi, so if there's another one out there, feel free to recommend it, and maybe I'll check it out in the future. If you're new to my channel, I also do monthly video game reviews, as well as an ongoing WWE 2K16 career mode series, where it is towards the end of 2018, I am a two-time Intercontinental Champion, and I sometimes think this game is on drugs because it can't figure out what it wants to do. So with that, I thank you guys for watching, and I'll see you next time.